And welcome to tonight's Lifelong Learning Lecture. We're pleased to have with us Tim Riley, NPR rock critic, Beatles author, and associate professor at Emerson College to tell us what Get Back gets wrong. A few notes before we begin. If you haven't already, please silence your cell phones. Evaluation forms are located at the back of the room, and we welcome any feedback you have about tonight's program and any ideas you have for future lectures as well. And we hope you'll join us on February 22nd for our next Lifelong Learning Lecture, 2024 presidential election so far, with Dr. David Smales. And with that, it's my great pleasure to welcome Tim Riley to Framingham Library today. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's good to be here. Thank you for coming out tonight and joining me. And my name is Tim Riley. I'm a Beatle author and I'm most widely known as a Beatle scholar. My background actually is as a classical piano player and a rock historian. So I've written books on the Beatles. I've spoken here before about Tina Turner, about Bob Dylan, and some different things. Tonight we're going to look at when Get Back gets wrong, because this was publicized in a very particular way. And how many of you have watched the Disney Get Back show? Okay, so for some of you, it might be real insider stuff. So you should ask questions along the way, because I don't want to get ahead of myself. But the general thesis is that what Get Back shows us is just one part of a larger story, and that they were trying to sell it in a way that was kind of disingenuous. Okay, so that's my thesis. And I'd like to start with a story I like to tell about, depending on what audience I have. But when I started at Emerson 15 years ago, they decided it would be a good promotional idea to give out a copy of my Beatle book to all incoming freshmen. So I had freshmen coming into my office and saying, oh, you've got to sign this book for me, I'm a big Beatle fan. And then other kids would say, oh, you've got to sign this book for me, my mom is the biggest Beatle fan. And then one kid came in and said, oh, you got to sign this for me. My grandfather is the biggest student. And of course, that joke doesn't work with college students, because they don't understand how those of us who were experiencing the music during the era, how it was youth music. It was specifically youth music. The idea that Paul McCartney would be on tour at age 82 was unimaginable, completely unimaginable. And it's one of the fascinating aspects of rock history that I'm really interested in, is how youth music grew up, right? And how it lasted much longer than anybody suspected it would, right? So that's just a couple of different side roads that I'm interested in. So some of you have seen it. How many of you remember seeing Let It Be in the theaters in 1970? So I did. I saw it. I was raised in Colorado. My local movie theater would show a matinee of three movies: A Hard Day's Night, Yellow Submarine, and Let It Be. And all three movies for a dollar. And I was there every weekend, and I watched those movies countless times. And Let It Be had a really profound effect on me on a young musician, as I did, I think, a lot of musicians, that doesn't get talked about a lot. And it was, if you know the movie, the first two-thirds of the movie are the Beatles in rehearsal. It was supposed to be a television program. They changed their mind in the middle of it and turned it into a movie. And they decided they needed a big climax. They were going to go play somewhere. They were looking at all different places they were going to go play. They were going to play at the Royal Albert Hall. They made a compromise settlement and finished by doing a rooftop performance on the top of the building that they were rehearsing in, which was the center of Apple Records, which they had begun the year before. So the two-thirds of the movie where the Beatles are rehearsing are notoriously boring, especially for non-musicians, because what you're hearing really is a bunch of songs that have really not taken shape yet. They're barely written, and they're busy figuring out, okay, they're busy demonstrating the songs for the other members of the band and getting some arrangement ideas. But they're really not very far along. And then when you get to the rooftop, you get this amazing climactic sequence where they play through some of the songs you've heard before, and they're all there. And it's kind of magical, and it's one of the great Beatles sets. And one of the things I really like about what Peter Jackson did is that he gave us the full rooftop sequence, and I went and saw it in the IMAX theater. And it was, you know, I don't know, we've been waiting a long time for it. It was really, really magical to see that, because so much of the live concerts that we see today, there's a lot of doctoring that goes on after the concert. I don't know if you know, the musicians call it sweetening. So after they finish the performance, they'll go in and add a guitar solo to make it sound just a little bit better than it did live. In the Beatles rooftop concert, in the sequence that Peter Jackson has put together, there is no sweetening. And it is absolutely amazing to consider the level of musicianship that they display on that rooftop completely live with no sweetening. All right, so my thesis is that Get Back gets things wrong, but you don't really understand why it gets things wrong unless you're a Beatles scholar, unless you understand the context. So this is the promo. It was, you know, they had to market it to a wide general audience because they had some really interesting material, but you know, the band is really old and a lot of the sequences are rehearsing and not sounding great, right? So when they were putting this project together, Paul McCartney was very scared that the sessions that Peter Jackson was gonna look at, which people hadn't looked at since 1969, he was very scared that it was going to be, there was going to be a lot of fighting. And it's very curious to me how his memory works, because what Peter Jackson discovered is that there's not a lot of fighting here. What Paul McCartney was remembering was the year later, when they released Let It Be, that's when they were really starting their feud. And it's very curious that McCartney misremembers about these sessions, because these sessions they're casual, they're not that great, but they are really interesting for scholars because we sort of get these clues about how certain things develop and about their working habits. So that's what I'm going to talk about. So they sold it like this, and Ben Cesario, who's a really good music critic, I respect him a lot, but this was basically the press release that Apple Records wanted the New York Times to run, which was, oh, this is all about the Beatles breaking up, okay? And it's very important to recontextualize that idea, because when you watch Let It Be, you need to understand we're in January of 1969. They are not breaking up. George Harrison does leave the sessions, but he comes back very quickly, and they keep it secret. I mean, I think it actually gets a small newspaper notice, but they do not publicize that they are fraying and falling apart. They are very much together, and they actually stay together for the rest of that year, 1969, and they create Abbey Road. What's curious about this is, so here's the timeline, right? So it's important to remember the context of where this session occurs. The session is in January of 1969. They're commonly referred to as the Get Back sessions. They take place in two different studios, a Twickenham movie studio, which is big and cavernous and cold for some reason. It's always been curious to me why the Beatles, the biggest band in show business history, can't find a rehearsal space that is warm. In other words, they're busy being cold in the Twickenham studios. It just always is like, I don't think Taylor Swift rehearses in a cold studio. Okay, so there's that, and then after George leaves and walks out, there's a big argument. He insists they not return to Twickenham. They go to the basement studio, which is almost done being built. It hasn't actually been built yet. With their producer, Glyn Johns, and they do the rest of the rehearsing in that basement studio, which is rather small and intimate. And Glyn Johns is, he gets called producer, he gets called engineer. I think that Get Back proves that he's actually working as a producer on this project. It's very curious. His title at Abbey Road is engineer, and he works for George Martin. And George Martin visits these sessions, and you see him in the movie, but he's like, well, Glyn started this session, I'm just gonna let him finish it. And the humility of George Martin is really quite astounding, because any other producer would wanna get his fingerprints all over it. But he was away for the first part of it. He wasn't scheduled to be part of this TV program. And when they changed their mind and turned it into a film and they're making a soundtrack for a movie, George Martin says, well, this guy started it, he can finish it. And Glyn Johns is very, very important to these sessions. And you can see Glyn Johns working in this movie, and he's very young. He's not even 25. The Beatles are 27, 28. Okay, so in November of 68, that's when they released the White Album. And November and December of, it shouldn't say December 69, it should say December 68. November and December of 68 are very busy months for both John and Yoko, right? So the White Album was out the 22nd. On the 18th of October, he's arrested for drug possession, and we now know that those drugs were planted in that apartment. This was a corrupt police guy who was trying to make a name for himself by getting a big celebrity arrest. And on the 21st of November, Yoko Ono has a miscarriage. And then the Rock and Roll Circus happens in December, and you can see that movie now. That movie remained unreleased for 40 years because the Rolling Stones didn't think that it was up to snuff. And the other rumor is that they think The Who upstaged everybody, so they didn't want to release a movie with The Who upstaging the host band. But John Lennon plays Your Blues in that, in that Rock and Roll Circus. So he's part of that Rock and Roll Circus. And then they gather again in the Twickenham Studios in January 1969. Now, nothing comes out of these sessions until April and May when we start to get some of the, these two songs, that Get Back and Don't Let Me Down, those are from these sessions. The Ballad of Johnny and Yoko is actually recorded in April. Old Brown Shoe, we now know, is recorded in March and April. But nothing else from these sessions gets released. And the reason they didn't release anything from these sessions is they thought they were subpar. They were walking away from this music. They thought, this isn't up to our standard. Maybe these sessions will lead to something better. And we now know in the Beatles' minds, what they were doing was, they were advancing towards Abbey Road. So they considered these sessions to be maybe not fruitful, but rehearsals towards the next recording project, which turns into Abbey Road. And here's how 69 looks. They do full-time sessions May through August of 69. September is when Abbey Road comes out. In March of 1970, this is when the big fight happens between Paul McCartney and the other three Beatles. The other three Beatles, because they have gotten into an argument about who's going to manage them, Paul McCartney has gone off to Scotland and made a homemade record. And he's come back and decided he wants to release it on the very same day that they want to release Let It Be. And that is one of the big fights that Lennon and McCartney have. And McCartney insists on going through with it, and he makes this announcement in March of 1970, I'm leaving the band, okay? That is when it is a big headline. That's when the Beatles' ending becomes highly publicized, and we understand, okay, the band is falling apart. And the album and the record comes out in May and released that summer in America, and it's very confusing to the audience because we have these headlines that the Beatles are broken up, but we have new Beatle material. But it's actually not new. It's actually almost a year and a half old, okay? So it's anachronistic. So the Beatles sat on this for over a year, and when they decide after Abbey Road, and part of it is they need to turn in a record for a contract obligation, and they're trying to negotiate a future contract. So it's a very complicated business situation. They decide they'll go back to Let It Be, and what do? They get the famous American producer, Phil Spector, to come over and produce all of these tapes. And there's a big controversy about whether Phil Spector did write by those sessions on Let It Be or not. And most people have really strong opinions about that. I have very mixed feelings about some of it. Paul McCartney writes a very famous letter, bitter letter, to Phil Spector saying, don't you ever do this again. He does not like the strings and the chorus that he put on Long and Winding Road. So that's Phil Spector's arrangement of Long and Winding Road. Paul McCartney was very upset about that. Paul McCartney didn't seem to mind that Phil Spector did the same thing to Across the Universe, which was a John Lennon song, okay? So it's fairly unband-like behavior. This is where this really starts, these fights. Okay, so there's this confusion in the public mind still about, if you say, so what's the last Beatle album, right? So the last Beatle album that they made together is Abbey Road. But the last Beatle album to get released is Let It Be. But it's very important to understand from the development of the music that Let It Be is actually recorded earlier, and then it's taken out of the vaults after a year by Phil Spector and produced for commercial release over a year after those sessions happened and after Abbey Road. Yes. They didn't think it was ready. They walked away from it. They said, these sessions are not our best sessions, and we can do better, and we're going to just sit on this for a while. Okay? It was the Beatles' own decision to not release it for that long a time. And it was the Beatles who hired Phil Spector to come in. And they thought, like, this is going to be a mess. We need a fixer to come in here and fix these sessions. Right? That's how they felt about it. Yeah? Question?
I'm beginning to think that Paul McCartney was a bit of a bully, because I know that George Harrison was very frustrated that he couldn't get his songs recorded by the group, and yet Something is one of the best songs they ever released. Here Comes the Sun. He also did Taxman, and my understanding is that both McCartney and Lennon just said, well, your stuff isn't as good as ours.
Yes.
Which, you know, is very debatable. I mean, some of their stuff, frankly, was crap.
Yes, yes.
And then you're telling us about the dispute over who's going to manage the group and then him wanting to release his own work on the same day as the group.
Yes.
And it's like, who put him in charge?
Yes, yes. So it's very, yes, no, it's a power struggle. It's very much a power struggle, yes. And Lennon, we have quotes from Lennon saying, oh, McCartney really, it's a Liverpool expression. He behaved with a lot of cheek, meaning faux charm, right? False charm. But he said, Paul was really smart. He used his announcement that he was leaving the band to sell a record. And I should have done that. We know that Lennon said, I want to leave the band in September 1969. But he entered into a secret agreement with his band members and with several journalists that he would not reveal this publicly because they were negotiating a future record contract, right? And I talked to the guy, one of the guy's name is, I think it's Ray Connolly, who Lennon had confided in, and Lennon called this guy up and got really mad at him. He said, why didn't you print it that I left the band? Why didn't you say, he said, you told me to keep it a secret. Oops, lost that. And Lennon said, well, you're the effing journalist. Very, very Lennon-esque. Okay. Power struggle, and you can see this whole George thread is very apparent in the Let It Be sessions, yes. The reason he walks out is he feels slighted by both Paul and John, and we now have this conversation that was recorded in the cafeteria where Paul and John talk quite candidly about they know they've been rude to George, they know that they've given him short shrift, they know that it's a wound in the band and they've just made it worse, and they don't exactly know how to fix it. And this is, but an important thing for my talk that I want you to take away is, this is the beginning, this is the rumblings of a band falling apart, but it's not the band falling apart yet, okay? So, when Lennon goes to the other band members in September of 1969, he pronounces he wants a divorce from the Beatles. Which I always think is like a really strange word choice to use if you're a band member and you want to leave the band and he wants a divorce. And he follows through on it too. He says, just like I got from Cynthia, I want a divorce. Right? Well, that gives you a real interesting clue to how strong those bonds were, right? And how making music for these four men was really an intimate act, right? Because he definitely talked about it in those terms. Okay. So there's another business story I need to go into when I talk about here. One of the things that Peter Jackson does really well is he really does a timeline very effectively. So now we know exactly which day he's choosing pieces of the session to deliver to us, and we get a really great timeline, which we never had before. But on this day, it's January 10th, they get a visit from Dick James. And it's a very awkward, stiff visit from a very cheerful man. Now, does anyone know who Dick James is? So Dick James is their music publisher. So what's a music publisher? Okay, so in the recording industry, this is very crude reduction of how a very complicated situation. But in the recording industry, you have two kinds of royalties. You have performance royalties, and then you have authorship royalties, right? And the authorship royalties are much more valuable, pay a lot more money than the performance royalties. And there's actually a quote from Ringo in this sequence on this day about how little money he makes. Because Lennon and McCartney are the songwriters, they get publishing royalty, author royalties. This is their publisher, and his job is to make sure that all of the Beatles' accounts are collecting the royalties that they are deserved from all the radio stations and all the record retailers and everybody where they collect songs. And he actually brings and says, you had actually a new person record this song from the White Album the other day. I'm here to tell you this, right? And we've also bought some new songs for the catalog. We own more songs now. So he's running the Lennon McCartney catalog. He's buying other publishing. He's a businessman. He owns this music as property, okay? He shows up on this day very jolly, and Lennon and Yoko wander off to the other part of the studio. They have no interaction with him. They treat him very disrespectfully, almost like he's not there. McCartney very grudgingly sits and takes an informal meeting with him, but really doesn't take much of an interest. This man, in March of 1969, he sells his interest in Northern Songs, the company that he started with Lennon and McCartney, without telling them. And this is a huge betrayal, and you get a hint of this betrayal in the middle of Get Back. But they don't see it. And he is playing, he's being overly nice and overly solicitous while he visits the band. And he's already planning that he's going to sell his shares. And when he sells his shares and Lennon and McCartney lose a majority stake in Northern Songs, that's when the Beatle catalog goes up for grabs, and it's been owned by bankers and various other holding companies ever since. And the Beatles feel totally betrayed by this, okay? So that's part of the subtext of what's going on when we see Dick James show up in this scene in the movie. But if you don't know that that's what's going to happen, it doesn't scan right. So it's like, who is this funny old guy, this bald guy with the glasses? What is he? And he just seems to be like a doddering old, oh, I'm just here to, you know, it's like library cards or something. It's just not very serious. But that's part of what's going on there. So here's the numbers, right? The other piece of this business deal that came out was when Dick James sold his shares, Lennon gets together with Paul McCartney. They know they're going to have to fight this. They want to try and gain back majority control of their own songwriting company to collect their publishing royalties. They don't want their publishing royalties to go to some bankers. And it's at this moment that John discovers that Paul has been buying up shares behind his back. And this is another huge betrayal that Lennon senses from within the band, okay? And McCartney's never answered for this. And I interviewed a guy, McCartney's brother-in-law, John Eastman, when I was working on my Lennon biography. And I said, you know, John Lennon complained about that till the day he died. I mean, he was very upset that Paul McCartney would buy shares in his company to get a bigger interest in their partnership without telling Lennon, on top of Dick James selling them out. And Eastman just shrugged and said, yeah, that's just business, you know, just like him. McCartney's, nobody's ever put the mic in McCartney's face and said, so what were you thinking? Why did you do this? How could you possibly? Lennon talked about this betrayal in many, many different interviews. But you can see here how the numbers in the publishing concern of the Beatles business, you can see how John and Paul have a much bigger share of publishing royalties than Ringo Starr and George Harrison. And that's because they set this company up in 1962 when they were just getting started. And that's why they are so attentive to their business matters today. And they release material every single fall to take advantage of the Christmas market because they feel like they got a raw deal. And they did. They got a bad contract, just like all young musicians do. Because they're young and naive, and all they want to do is make a recording, and they're taking advantage of. This is the oldest story in show business, right? All right, so it's important to look at those numbers and understand that double betrayal from. And this is Paul saying he quit the Beatles April 10th, 1970. And this is Paul's publicity for his own solo album. Okay? Now, this is the September 20th meeting where they agreed that they're going to have Alan Klein be their manager. There's been a back and forth about this. Paul McCartney wants his brother-in-law and father-in-law, the John Eastman firm in New York, Linda's family, to represent his business interest and the Beatles. And the other Beatles like, no, actually, we don't want your in-laws controlling our piece of the business. That's not going to fly here. And McCartney's also never answered for that. Right? Nobody has said, so how come you're trying to push your in-laws? I mean, why didn't they go to a neutral party? Alan Klein was a known snake in the music industry, but he was famous for getting the Rolling Stones back royalties. He was famous, he actually helped set up Sam Cooke with his own record company. He's a very interesting character, but there's a scene in the Get Back sequence where Glyn Johns is trying to warn Lennon off of Alan Klein, and Lennon is just so excited about meeting Alan Klein, and Alan Klein has played his hand really well. He's come in knowing Lennon's material. He's come in saying, I was an orphan just like your dad, and I know you were orphaned too, in a sense, in a very loose sense. This is the meeting where they sign, this is a management deal, and this is famously a contract that McCartney never signs. So McCartney walks out of this meeting without signing, and they don't notice it till later, but he says, oh, Alan Klein never represents me. Okay, so all of that stuff is going on that whole year. So I think the important thing to understand about the Get Back movie is that, to me, it's kind of a miracle that they kept recording all the way through 1969 and producing Abbey Road, given the enormity of the business fights that they were busy confronting. And the fights just got bigger and bigger into 1970 and 71 because McCartney didn't want to play ball with Alan Klein, he winds up suing the other three Beatles. And that becomes another big court case. And again, McCartney's very sanctimonious about all of this, but he's never had like a real hard-nosed journalist sit down and say, so you did this, you said this, you acted, what made you do that? How could you behave that way and not expect the other three Beatles to be upset about it, right? But he's happy-go-lucky Paul. He's like, you know, like breezy, happy. Like he sold this personality to the world. And I think a lot of it's true, but he has this really hard business edge that most of us don't see. Okay, so I think it's kind of miraculous that we not only get the Let It Be album, because a sloppy Beatle rehearsal actually turns out to be a lot more interesting than most people's really polished rehearsals in a certain way. Even though it's raggedy, there's still a lot of great musicianship on it. And the number of ideas per second is kind of astonishing. Now, I was very taken with these sessions as a kid, and I've always been, so I sat fascinated watching this. My wife watched about an hour and said, I just can't get this, it's not for me, right? So it's not for everybody, but I do think that creative people, writers, musicians, showbiz people, I think watching the Beatles' creative process, maybe especially because it's kind of boring, it's actually kind of reassuring to the rest of us because it shows the Beatles, this is how hard it is. We may wind up sounding magical, but the rehearsal process is drudgery. It really takes a lot of hard work, and certain days are just write-offs. They just don't get anything done. And you see that through Get It Back, and you're sort of like, this isn't working. What are they gonna do with all of this? And then they go up on the rooftop and they play that rooftop set, and you realize they were not playing to the cameras. They were not showing all of the ensemble that they had in their back pocket. And the rooftop ensemble is really kind of crazy great. All right, so this is the, so this is September 69. This is May of 1970. This is May of 1970, right? And one of my favorite sequences, we can't play it because we don't have audio, but one of my favorite sequences is Lennon and McCartney face-to-face singing Two of Us in Scottish brogue, angry clenched teeth Scottish brogue. And I urge you to look it up. It's absolutely hilarious. And it takes place on January 25th. And it gives you an idea of how they were, how freewheeling they were in their creativity. They would try everything with a song just to see what worked. And literally singing it in a Scottish brogue And it's very funny, they're looking at each other, they're cracking each other up. You can tell, this was a familiar territory for them. They would often just twist songs way out of shape and do them way oddball ways in order to see how far they could stretch things. Okay, this is the rooftop concert, very famous rooftop concert. We just had the anniversary, January 30th, 1969. All of these cables and everything, they all go down, literally down four flights of stairs to Glyn Johns's studio in the basement, and they are live to tape, and we see them in Get Back, play the rooftop session, and then we see them listening back to the rooftop session, and it's a glorious session. The Beatles themselves, apparently, they were surprised at how great it came off. And there's a couple of things to remember about this rooftop session that it's important to emphasize. We think the temperature that day was around 42 degrees. Okay, so you see them going like this and making eyes at each other. It's so hard. It's hard to hold. It's hard to play. It's hard to get around. And they're all wearing coats. And so it's really cold on that London rooftop. And you realize they have miscalculated. They think, oh, we'll go up to the rooftop and play a rooftop show. Great. Nobody checked the weather. Yeah. And they all thought, oh, this will be a great lark. And it was a great lark, right? And a crowd did assemble at the bottom. One of my favorite little bits in the Get Back movie is Ringo goes from behind the drums and peeks over the edge of the building to see the crowd below. Because he can hear them, he knows they're there, but he goes and he peeks. It's really great to see Ringo Starr. I want to see how many people down there, right? The sequence in the original movie is, I think, flawed because you're getting these great songs going by and the ensemble's really magical. And then they cut away to these people who are like, do you know who this is? And like, oh, this is a terrible nuisance in the middle of a business day. And all these varied reactions, like, I don't care about these reactions. I don't. Don't cut away from Don't Let Me Down. We want to hear Don't Let Me Down, right? Okay, so that's what's going on there. This, I just to remind you briefly, this, it's very interesting to note that on the 17th of January, that's when the Yellow Submarine soundtrack comes out, which the Beatles were very ambivalent about sending songs to that soundtrack, and they sent them All You Need Is Love and Blue Jay Way and a couple others from other albums. They poached things from other albums to help flesh that out. That side, one side of that album is Beatles songs. The other side is George Martin arrangements for the soundtrack of Yellow Submarine. We don't count it as a full-fledged Beatle album because Yellow Submarine actually is a song that comes off Revolver. All You Need Is Love. It's been a big hit, but it's never been on an album. It's only been a single. Okay, but it's really interesting to think that the Beatles are in their Get Back sessions in Twickenham, and as they're rehearsing, this album and film are getting released. Really interesting. Okay, so this is the last Beatle album that gets released, but it's not recorded last. It's not, strictly speaking, the last album they ever record, and then we get into the greatest hit stuff that starts happening in 73. These two records have just been re-released and remastered, and I'm conversing with Beatles scholars now. We're listening very carefully. One of the things that Peter Jackson did in this movie was he developed some digital technology that allowed them to focus and identify each particular voice. So it's an early version of AI, artificial intelligence, and they used this digital technology to isolate each instrument and isolate each vocalist so that they could get a better mix and they'd get a better transcript of what was going on. So they now use this technology on the remasters of these two greatest hits packages, and we are hearing things on these Beatle remasters that we've never heard before. And it's kind of thrilling. And it's kind of astonishing how they keep cleaning it up. They always remaster with the latest technology. Now we're sort of saying, now we need to go back and remaster the remasters from 10 years ago because we have such the technology's advanced. And the strangest thing is that, yes, we all love the Beatles, and we all know the Beatles are great, but the more you hear in a Beatle recording, the more it gets cleaned up, the better it gets. It's kind of astonishing. Most people wouldn't work that way. Most people, you'd keep cleaning it up and say, oh yeah, there's a stray noise over there. Oh yeah, that's a mistake. No, we have I'm hearing hand claps in songs that I've never heard hand claps in before. Fascinating stuff, right? So it's sending us Beatles scholars around doing, we have a whole lot of work to do. These two albums are widely regarded as good places to start. If you're new coming to the Beatles, those are good greatest hits packages. This is a different collection. There's all kinds of these odd collections. If you have these two things, you don't really need this. This is just a collection of singles. But this was, the Past Masters project was a CD project. So early on, when I came to Boston, I wrote a review of the Past Masters singles collection because it was the first time some of these singles had ever appeared on CD, and I wrote a big review about it for the Boston Phoenix in 1988. And that was my first piece in the Boston Phoenix. All right, so I was gonna play us out with One After 909, because I have a deep sentimental spot for One After 909. Does everyone know when One After 909 was written? It's worth putting on just a couple seconds of it because you'll really enjoy it. And it's, oh, no, that's not what I want. Don't do that. Do that. Oh, it's not doing it. All right, the one time I try and play it, it's not there. One After 909 actually was written in 1963, and there's actually a recording of the Beatles doing it. I think it's for their second album. I'd have to go look that up. But it's an early song, and they considered it a throwaway. It wasn't up to snuff. They left it behind. They left it in the vaults. They returned to it on the rooftop. It's very, very charming because they're reviving an old rock and roll number of their own. And it's sort of like they're covering one of their favorite old rock and rollers, but it just happens to be their rock and roll song. And it's a really fun, rollicking song about missing the girlfriend because you got the train number wrong, right? And it's very Chuck Berry spirit and just full of high energy and good cheer. And the ensemble on One After 909 is just fantastic. It's just one of the great rock and roll things they do. And I just love it that they're returning to something they did 6 years earlier, but they didn't like the lyric to it. They thought, oh, well, this isn't a good song. And they brought it back up in these sessions, and it revived their sessions, and everyone said, oh, you got to do that one. So that's the story of, all right, so that's the end of my remarks. I'm hoping there's some stuff that we might talk about. You might have questions. I'm known for my fast talking. I'm known for my obsession with detail and all things Beatles and Beatle myth. I'm sure there's stuff that I haven't talked about that I'd be happy to talk about now. So yes, what are you thinking?
Before you began to speak, you were seeing representations of, or the covers of lots of different books that you've written.
Yes.
And Madonna, Bob Dylan, several about the Beatles. How do you decide which artists to focus on for your work?
So it's a combination of what you know the publisher will want and what the publisher can sell, right, and then your own passion about rock and roll story. And it's a big story, and there's lots of cool little corners in that story. There's a lot of, I have done many more book pitches than I've sold books, definitely. And three of my books are devoted to the Beatles, and I never thought I'd wind up with three, but we needed a Lennon biography because we hadn't had a Lennon biography in over 20 years, and the last one by an American was Albert Goldman, and it's a scam. It's a terrible, terrible book written in a terrible spirit. he has no empathy at all for Lennon. I had to reread it when I started, and it was the worst part of working on my Lennon biography was rereading Albert Goldman. But there was a place in the market for a new, major new John Lennon biography, and so that's what the publisher, that's why we sold that. And then I had Oxford University Press came and said, hey, we don't have a textbook yet. We need a textbook on the Beatles. So a friend of mine, Walter Everett, and I, we wrote a textbook. And it's the very first textbook on the music of the Beatles. Yeah.
So I have to thank you when you said that you're planning a book on Taylor Swift.
No, I just did a newsletter issue about it. So you could go look me up on Substack. I have a newsletter. It's called the Riley Rock Report. But I did review the Taylor Swift movie. And I was kind of enchanted in a way that I didn't expect. And yes, she has crossed over the Rubicon from celebrity into, one of my favorite Lennon quotes is, he says, The Beatles are getting very famous in Britain in the summer of 63, and a journalist says, so, you know, how do you deal with a celebrity? He says, oh, this isn't celebrity. This is something else. In other words, he was aware that the seismic shift that was happening in culture of which they were a part, it was reflecting changes much bigger than any celebrity. And I think Taylor Swift is now in that rarefied zone of, you know, she's so much more than a pop star, right? I should stop talking now, because I shouldn't talk about how funny I think it is that the MAGAs are really upset that she's upstaging the Super Bowl. And it's funny, everyone's writing about it. It's like it's the lead of the Super Bowl story is now has Taylor Swift in it, and they hate that. They just want their football. And I'm very curious how this story's gonna play out. I have some suspicions that it's going to end badly. Number one, I don't think you can have a normal relationship when you have that the world's attention like that. So I don't think you see a lot of abnormal behavior in celebrity relationships, and it's because it's not really a normal relationship, right? The other thing is, like many other Taylor Swift fans, I take pause with how her stock has boosted the NFL stock. Nobody has gone and gotten a quote from Colin Kaepernick. And I'm really curious how this will play out. And it's not so much about an endorsement of Biden as it is, what happens when they say, hey, what do you make of dating this guy who's part of a racist organization, who's part of a misogynist, like they cover up all of these domestic abuse cases, right? What do you make? She's very frank, and she leans progressive, and she understands that she has a voice, and she has used her voice very, very strategically. And I just have my concerns about how it's going to play out, because I don't know how you get a sweet, happy ending with the story as it is right now. It's very hard for me to imagine a sweet, happy ending. Even if they get married.
Why do you say that?
Because I know that politically, she understands that boosting the NFL stock goes against a lot of her politics.
Against a lot of
her politics, yeah. And what is she gonna, when she is pressed with the question, hey, some people call the NFL a racist organization, what do you say to that? She will speak her mind. Yeah, it's a racist organization. Yes. No, Colin Kaepernick, famously a black quarterback, taking a knee at football games. COVID sort of, our memories are so short, and COVID really swept that under the rug, but it's a sleeping giant. It's kind of a volcano that's still got to go off. As soon as it occurs to someone to interview Kaepernick again, as soon as his name hits the news again, people are gonna say, oh, well, Taylor Swift, are you going to get Kelsey to take a knee, right? And it'll all just come rushing back. I mean, it's never over. Yes.
Yeah, I just want to go back to the Beatles for a minute.
Yeah, sure.
I just remembered I was in Detroit during the very early 60s, and I remember hearing some of the Beatles songs. I can't remember which songs I would hear.
Yes.
And all of a sudden, I would pull over, and I never did that before or
yes.
since, but it was so, oh my God, this
yes.
is terrific.
Yes, you hear stories like this all the time. So I'm a little bit younger, just a teensy bit younger. I was born in 1960. So for me, Let It Be and Abbey Road, those are my first two Beatle things. So I'm 10 years old when they come out, and I'm enraptured. I'm a kid who's just like, this is the coolest thing ever. But yes, I have heard stories like this about, and I've often wondered what it must have been like to go through high school. So if Sgt. Pepper came out your senior year of high school, and then you go to college and you get the White Album and you get Abbey Road, like their coming of age story was a parallel, it was a larger coming of age story, obviously, for the whole audience. And I think there was an excitement it's very hard to convey to my Emerson students how much excitement was in the air and how how meaningful a relationship everyone had with the Beatles. Like you said, pulling the car over the side of the road. Because the music is that magical. It's just like I can't hear and drive at the same time. I have to stop because I have to hear. Yeah.
The early 60s, I mean, it's a magical time. I was at the University of Michigan, and Joan Baez was there.
Yeah.
And there were other attendees.
Yeah.
But I mean, it seemed like the explosion of folklore.
Yes. No, something really happened in the 60s. It's a moment that we're still taking stock of, we're still making sense of, and it's not as simple as, oh, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Like, I hate the whole monolithic idea about the 60s. 60s were incredibly complicated, and lots of violence, and lots of political conflict. And, you know, some of it would strike us as very familiar today. Some of these old wounds are still kind of fresh. But I like the quote from Greil Marcus, a famous rock critic. He said, excitement wasn't in the air, it was the air. That's how it felt, yeah.
I saw them at the Garden in 64.
Oh, God.
It was unbelievable. You literally couldn't hear what they were
You
saying.
Couldn't hear them, right? Right. Which is one reason they stopped touring was, so try and put yourself back in 60s technology, and they're filling stadiums beyond what we have the technology to fill the stadiums up with. Now it's gotten very sophisticated, right? And when you're Bruce Springsteen or Taylor Swift or Beyonce, you're working a stadium of 60, 70,000, and you have this beautiful sound mix in your ear. And if you look into the tapes, you can see everyone wears these earplugs. That's because they have a sound person, they have a staff that makes sure what they hear in their ear is perfectly balanced so they can make great. The Beatles did not have stage monitors. They had a hard, Ringo talks about looking at the others to see where they were in the song, yeah. So the Beatles, after a couple of years, and they toured the world for 3 or 4 years, depending on how you count, they were very sort of disheartened about how going out and playing a concert wasn't really about the music. Right? It was about that something else. It was about hero worship, it was about we identify so strong with these values, with these ideas, these magical ideas you're putting out there. But the Beatles couldn't hear themselves, and that was very frustrating. Yeah.
I gotta change the subject. What is so special? I don't mean sarcastically. But why are people loving Taylor Swift so much?
So, I have my own ideas about it. You'll hear, like, everyone will have different ideas about that, but. Here's what I wrote about. I went to see the concert, and I got a little bit bored in the middle, and I was a little bit, as a musician, I was a little bit underwhelmed by some of the songs. But the mood of the audience, the bond she has with her audience, the way people sing with her every single word, the people know all her catalog by heart, and the rapture that was alive in that audience. And I was talking with my wife about it when I got home, and I realized I didn't get it. And she said, it's about girlhood. And it's about girlhood. And girlhood has not occupied such a big space in pop culture until now. And what Taylor Swift offers is a kind of a confirmation, an affirmation of all of the insecurities of preteens and teens that makes them feel, oh, somebody gets me. And that's happened before with different female artists, sure, but she has made it her subject, and she is really quite, it's quite ingenious what she's doing, and I mean that aesthetically, is that she's, she has that X factor that what we talk about with celebrities, right? She's a good musician. She's not that great a dancer. It's really interesting to watch the show. She's like, and her dancers have to work hard not to upstage her, but she's not really an especially great singer. But the stamina and the commitment that she puts into her singing and the communion that she has with her fans is really extraordinary. I mean, extraordinary. And I've been to a lot of concerts, and this concert movie it's really worth watching because it's kind of like, how come no one's figured this out before? They're tapping a new vein, and it's about, you know, and I didn't get it, because I'm a guy. But it's about girlhood, it's about femalehood, how it feels to be a woman coming of age in today's culture and getting songs that are all about you and your identity.
Where do you see a concert film?
Where do you see a concert film? Well, you can stream it.
Oh,
yeah, they have it on streaming, sure. Yeah, you should go watch it, for sure. Yeah, you would. You would like it, I think. You would like it. She's incredibly sweet. She's just extraordinarily sweet. You don't get any cynicism off of this woman. It's kind of amazing. It's kind of amazing. So that's my take on it. I'm sure there's other good takes, but I turned my head around about, you know, and then we saw the Beyonce movie too, and the Beyonce movie is very good too. It's worth seeing both of those.
There was one right-wing commentator who said that she's a witch and has cast a spell.
Yeah.
But I want to get back to the Beatles.
Yeah.
So Paul McCartney released a two-volume set where he was reviewing all of the songs that he said were his songs,
yes,
his compositions, and the commentary on that. I was wondering what you thought of that work.
So I have a friend who I went to music school with who got to play a session with McCartney. And I'll tell you that about that in a minute. But before I tell you that, you should know what my wife says before I launch into that story, which is, you tell that McCartney story a lot, and you don't even like Paul McCartney that much. I've always been mostly a Lennon guy, right? So there's two camps, right? Now, I am very respectful of McCartney, of his work. I think my essay of his song Hey Jude is like one of the strongest pieces of my first book, and I think that song is genius top to bottom. But McCartney, his memory is flawed, so he keeps telling stories about things where he was not in the room, and he remembers being in the room and being in the wrong country on that date. So scholars are always like, what is this guy talking about? So when you start doing research on the Beatles, you start to realize, oh, these primary sources, they're not good sources. So Cynthia Lennon, John Lennon's first wife, has two memoirs. She gets her wedding date wrong in both memoirs. And, you know, that's just the state of, I mean, but you can imagine being in the middle of all that noise, of all that energy, of all that chaos. I'm sure I would forget my wedding date. primary sources of Beatles, they're flawed. McCartney's rememberings about who wrote which part of what song, they can be very useful, and I use them sometimes in my books, and sometimes I don't trust them. Sometimes I'm not sure. Sometimes I write them and I say, I'm not sure how I feel about this, whether this could be true. For instance, he insisted for a long, long time that he was the sole author of Yesterday, right? And he even came across a song sheet of Yesterday was written out, and his name was missing because there wasn't enough space for both Lennon and McCartney, and he was very upset to see just Lennon's name there, and he lobbied Yoko Ono for years to give him sole authorship for the one song Yesterday. Well, we know now from interviews that have been dug up that McCartney actually did help him with writing Yesterday and was a co-author, and so there's some of this stuff that McCartney's going on about, and Lennon's not here to answer, and it's really unfortunate, but he's lost a certain amount of credibility with some of us scholars because he's a great storyteller and he's a very charming man. Anyway, so my friend, the musician, did a session with Paul McCartney. So my friend, the musician, was the lead guitar player for the Paul Simon Band, and you'll see him in the videos. He has long red hair. His name is Mark Stewart. Wonderful guy, wonderful musician. And they have a day off in L.A., and Paul Simon calls up the rest of the band and says, we're going to make you play tonight because my friend Paul McCartney needs us to do this charity gig. We're going to play this charity gig. And they're very upset that they have one day off and they have to go play this charity gig. They reluctantly go on stage to play the charity gig. Turns out to be one of the great shows of the tour because Paul McCartney's in the front row and he's singing along with everything and dancing. And of course, if you're a musician and Paul McCartney is enjoying your music making, you are delirious, right? The next day he goes to a rehearsal studio And his guitar technician says, "Oh, it's good you came by today. Paul McCartney's been asking for you. He'd like you to come join the session." And he goes to the next door studio, and McCartney says, "Oh, I'm so glad you came by. I really want to try out this song with a second guitar, but I play it myself, but I'm too lazy. But here, I'll show you how to do it." And he hooks him up and plays the guitar, and he plays the session with it, and he plays the concert that night with the Paul McCartney band. And he said, Paul McCartney could not have been more charming, more solicitous, more generous, more sweet. And I love that story so much, because that could have been me. And all musicians, I still have dreams about I'm in a room playing with the Beatles or playing with these other people and all musicians have that kind of fantasy, and my good friend Mark got to play it out. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful story.
Bob and I are trustees of the library.
Yes. I'm sure you could find them. You should call. Call the New England Conservatory and call Berklee School of Music. Yeah, they'll hook you up. Yeah. There are people who play that music, that old, really old music, in this town. I'm sure. All right. So I want to close with one of my favorite show business jokes, because it just reminded me. Telling that story reminded me of this joke, and it's too good not to tell. So it's the Glenn Miller Band, and they're on tour, and they get called, they have a day off, and they get called to do an extra show, and Glenn Miller makes them show up, and they do it, and they have to go take a train from Chicago, and it starts to snow, and they get off the train, and it's really snowing hard, and they have to walk a mile and a half into this town out in the sticks to some veterans hall where they're going to play this show, and it's snowing like crazy, and then it starts to get really muddy, and the wind is whipping them, and they walk by this house, and it's up on a little hill, and through the scenic window of the front of the house, they see this family sitting down to a nice turkey dinner, and they look so warm and cozy, and they're hauling their instruments in the snow and the rain and the wind, and one of the guys turns to the other musician and says, "I don't know how people live like that." It's a musician joke. Thank you very much for coming tonight. That was really, really fun.
Music.